Now, as you probably figured out, Series 1 is an incredibly consistent series, so this is less the worst and more of the least good. I like Series 5, in my opinion. But the reason why this is at the bottom is because, well, it would be higher if it was out in another series. It's just this. Of all the other episodes we have, that it's good, but it's not as good as the others. It can't top all the others, and it's 10 years now, and it's consistent, and there are the least good, but with the least good, it gets overlooked, and this one gets massively overlooked. Like, when you mention Series 1, not many people go straight to the long game. In fact, I kind of have to bring it up for people to talk about the long game. And as usual, Christopher Eccleston is great, and Simon Pegg is a surprisingly good villain, but it's just not as good as the others, and it can't top it. And that's why it's at the bottom. Boomtown, I enjoy this episode, I really do, but there is one massive problem I have with this episode. It's not the Slovene are back, they're kind of a good villain, but it's because of that we spend so much time in this episode between Rose and Mickey. And what I don't get is Russell T. Davies wants us to take Rose's side. Okay, but bearing in mind, she left her boyfriend for some complete stranger, disappeared for a year, Mickey got in trouble for it, and she didn't even apologize. And she moans at Mickey for getting another girlfriend. That's one of the central conflicts of this episode, and I just can't take it. I hate it when we're supposed to support somebody who's completely in the wrong. And yeah, it started out funny as first at the start of the episode, but when it got to that scene when she was talking about the different planets and they started arguing. No! Rose had no right to say that it was her fault, his fault. It's completely her fault, and when I'm supposed to support her, it's just not right. And it's such a shame because the rest of the episode is good, but this is just really, really annoying. Okay, so this at the time would have been the first step in time for the viewers. And as an introduction to the whole world and the future and all that, they definitely picked a good place to start. I mean, the end of the earth. Wow. And this episode is enjoyable. It really is. And now we're getting to the. It's not the best and it's not the least good. It's kind of in the middle. But I will put it on if I'm bored. But to be honest, it's more of Rose in this episode. Like, I feel like we should as she keeps the way she argued with Cassandra and that conflict of her and the doctor. Just felt like it came too soon. I mean, if she, it felt like it should have come out of if she saw her d him do something, but it just came out of nowhere. But Platform One and all the aliens, great designs, and to be honest, it feels like they spent the budget well, and for the special effects from 2005, it holds up well. But as I said, the conflict between Rose and the Doctor, I feel like it should have come out after something instead of out of nowhere. Okay, this episode I really do enjoy because it's kind of like, as it says, First Contact, and it's actually pretty funny to see all what London reacts to having a ship crash into Big Ben. And to be honest, I really like this episode with Jackie slapping the Doctor, and to be honest, Christopher Eccleston plays the Doctor absolutely amazing. So this is absolutely brilliant. And we see UNIT for the first time, and the scene where the Doctor goes off on his own, which I think we should see more of, is hilarious, especially when all the soldiers point their gun at him and he just smiles. And I'm not sure if you know this, but Naoko Mori, who plays Toshiko in Torchwood, she's in this, which I find is absolutely crazy. I know the space pig you may think is a crazy idea, but how the Doctor just saw it and just went hello, and it did lead into a pretty good scene, and the Doctor moaning at the soldier for just shooting at it. And the cliffhanger. It was a pretty good cliffhanger until the next time trailer came on and we saw the Doctor in a completely different room, non-electrocuted and not dead or unconscious. Okay, that's why you either, if you do have a next time trailer after a cliffhanger, think about what you're putting in it, or put very little in it, or just don't have one. So, mainly it's just a cliffhanger that ruins this episode, because it just ruins the cliffhanger. It's annoying. Now, just picture for a moment, listening to this episode. Giant green monsters who get killed by vinegar are invading 10 Downing Street. You may not take that very seriously, but it does actually do it pretty well, I have to admit. And admittedly, the CGI, when they're running in a corridor, doesn't age well at all. It is still a good episode, and they did set up a good villain for the Sarah Jane Adventures. And, as usual, Christopher Eccleston, he's a very big part of selling this episode, especially in that lift scene and that history lesson. And yeah, Harriet Jones, she's a good character. I mean, they could have easily made her one of those annoying people like, oh, I'm a politician, I'm in charge. But no, they actually made her a decent character. And obviously she's the one to save the situation and make that big speech. And Mickey and Jackie, they did incorporate them into the episode well. They could have just made Mickey the person who was like, oh, I can't do anything. But they actually made him part of the solution. And to be honest, a missile in 10 Downing Street, I can't imagine that most people would wish that would happen. Partly because they hate politicians. So this is a good episode, and admittedly, the villains can't be taken as seriously as the others, but it's a good episode. The first Christmas special, and it is enjoyable. I mean, this is David Tennant's first episode, and he has about 10 minutes of screen time, maybe 15. And most of this episode is focusing on UNIT, Torchwood, Harriet Jones, and Rose. Yeah, good job is Russell T. Davis didn't make her argue pointlessly with anybody this time. And the Sycorax are a good villain considering they're invading. And they have to set this up with mystery considering the Doctor isn't figuring it out. Rose has to do it. And the build up to the Doctor's reveal is very good, and then he just bursts out of the TARDIS, doesn't stop talking for 5 minutes, has a sword fight, gets his arm cut off, and then goes for a Christmas party. Defeats the Sycorax with an orange. I mean, I'm when I think about it, I'm underwhelmed that the Doctor defeated the Maya with a recording. But when it comes to the Sycorax, them being the leader being defeated by an orange, that's okay. I have no idea why, but what you can do. It's a Christmas episode, and it's a really good one. Honestly, one of the greatest ways to say be careful what you wish for. Yes, it's Father's Day. One of the episodes that I find really enjoyable to watch, and you could call this a Doctor Light episode, but when you think about it, it is really a story centered around Rose and her dad. And to be honest, this is what everybody would do if they had a chance to go back to see a dead loved one. They would do it, and they'd probably change time. And the Reapers, the way they were introduced with the whole TARDIS becoming a normal police box, brilliant. And this one, feel like this was the one that solidified the Doctor and Rose's relationship. And it's just a great episode, and one of the best single parters in Doctor Who. The first episode of New Who, it had to attract a new audience, it had to attract old audiences, and the Autons were a good choice to start off with. They're basic, they don't really need that much explanation, so it leaves enough time to explain the Doctor, and you could say this is a Doctor-like episode. And it's a good one. This has got to explain enough for the audiences to come back next week, and it does. It's a great episode, and even though the Doctor doesn't appear in it much, that speech when he's walking back to TARDIS is just brilliant. And all I can say is Christopher Eccleston, again, he's one of the best parts of this episode. For what is essentially Doctor Who's first attempt at a ghost story, yeah, this is a good one. Mark Gatiss, as always, he delivers. And when you have a zombie / ghost story, you kind of have to sell it. Because when Doctor Who does ghosts, you're expecting it to be alien or anything supernatural even. But this, yeah, it's alien, but it's very close to supernatural. And all the Gelf, great villain, and Simon Callow as Charles Dickens. Man, it's the only time I've ever been interested in Charles Dickens. Because, to be honest, I'm not very interested in classic literature, so some of these references I did catch, but just seeing Charles Dickens fighting ghosts with the Doctor, that's just brilliant. So we're into our top five, and kicking it off is The Empty Child. Yep, the episode that made Gasmos creepy as hell. So, Stephen Moffat's first episode, and it's a pretty good one. Unlike Hellbent, I'll get to that later. Anyway, this one is really good, and Captain Jack, great intro. I still can't believe we're getting more of him in the Torchwood audiobooks. He's a great character. And honestly, John Barrowman plays him so well, like, it's like the perfect part for him. I have no idea how they managed to find somebody who fit the role so well. Chris Freckleston does well, especially that scene I've always liked when he talks to that cat, and Dr. Constantine and Nancy. And this episode is kind of split into two until they reach the hospital. It's got the Doctor with Nancy and Dr. Constantine, and Rose with Jack. Yeah, And this episode, it's the first part which it serves it really well. The Blitz, all of it, really good. And the cliffhanger. That's what I call a cliffhanger. Well, this is part of what I like to call Stephen Moffat's best. And this is an amazing second part to an amazing two-part. And this is something Stephen Moffat, I think, is the only one who managed to do. He pulls the same trick twice. That scene where they're listening to the tape and it stops and you don't notice. And then the doctor points it out. That was creepy, but when they do it again, but they make it even more obvious. When that kid is typing a message to his mum on the typewriter, then they cut to Nancy, then they cut back, and then kid has moved to next to the other kid. And the typewriter is still going, and he manages to do it again. This is one of the things that Stephen Moffat does the best. He manages to pull the same trick twice without overdoing it. That is kind of worn off, but he still managed to make gas mask creepy. He managed to pull off the same part. The cliffhanger worked well and everything was resolved pretty nicely, and we thought we were gonna see Captain Jack die, and he would have made a good one-off companion. But then he actually got brought onto the TARDIS. So that was just great. Now this second story of the Dalek stories in series 1 isn't the best. But I'll get to that later. This is a good example of how to do a mystery in Doctor Who. It starts off with the game station, which was Platform 1, and I'm pretty glad that they decided to do this, show the aftermath of one of the Doctor's adventures. And the build-up towards the Daleks, it was well handled, even though it was revealed there was the Daleks in the next time trailer from Boomtown. Yes, I actually revealed the mystery before the mystery even was started. But they still handled it well, and it was really good. The cliffhanger, gotta love it. One of the Ninth Doctor's greatest moments. And the games itself, they're all cancelled now. So it's either nostalgia for people who liked old game shows, but it's still a good episode, and the fall of Doctor and Big Brother. Come on. That's just crazy. And Jo Joyner as Linda. I would be happy to have her as a companion for Series 2. I really would have. She's a really good character, and of course, Captain Jack and the Doctor. That is just brilliant how they work together. Doctor Who needs to hire Robert Shearman again. I mean, he wrote he wrote a Dalek so well that I found a single Dalek more threatening than an entire army's worth in The Magician's Apprentice. Like, seriously. And that was by the head writer. Seriously, Dalek just does it so well. I mean, it proves you only need one Dalek to make them threatening. And that's exactly what it does. You can tell their new audiences can tell that these guys are dangerous, because even the Doctor starts off scared of them. Then he totally turns the tables, and then he electrocutes the Dalek. And that's the main focus of the episode, and it does it so well. The Doctor trying to kill the last Dalek. And admittedly, the only reason why this isn't at number one is Rose. I don't get why I know she hasn't seen the Doctor like this, but she moans at the Doctor for trying to kill this killed the Dalek when she doesn't know what the Daleks have done. And I know it became more human, but still, she isn't really in any position to judge. And that scene where the Doctor tries to kill the Dalek, man, that's just brilliant. And then the Dalek just kills itself because it doesn't want to become more human. That is how you write Dalek, Stephen Moffat. Take note. So, here we are. Number one, Christopher Eccleston's final episode, The Parting of the Ways. Man, not only is it a great series finale, but it's a great finale for Christopher Eccleston. You can tell from the start, you enjoy it from his start to his final scene. And the reason why series one is so consistent, it's partly thanks to Christopher Eccleston. He is such a great actor. And I think the fact that he has done one series and hasn't come back for any big finish like the classic Doctors, it's really sad because that would be so good. Like, it's not just the Doctor that's done well. Rose is really good in this episode. The fact that she won't need the Doctor. Captain Jack. The fact that when we first saw him a couple of episodes ago, he was a complete coward. Now he's willing to fight to the death against things he knows he can't beat, but he will fight until he gets killed just to give the Doctor more time. And all that, and it's led up to whether the Doctor can push a button. Whether he becomes a killer, or stays the way he's always been. And you can tell, this is like a continuation from Dalek. The conflict, he wants to get rid of the Daleks, but he just can't. And his final scene, it's not like David Tennant's speech where he goes absolute crazy, or Matt Smith's speech where he kind of says you have to move on. He has to explain regeneration. And the way he does that, it's just really good. The way that he just blabbers on and he seemed like he's talking absolute rubbish, but then he actually gets somewhere. And then David Tennant, we get introduced to David Tennant. This is honestly a great series finale. And series one is what, this is quite hard to rank, I'll tell you this now. From the least good to the most good, I was honestly stuck between this and Dalek. But this is just brilliant. So, that's all 14 episodes of Series 1 ranked. Now, there aren't many other series that are less good. Series 5, I have to admit, it may just be me, but I find that, like Series 1, the least good, not the worst. But the rest, yeah. Series 2 next. So, join me then for we rank Series 2.